I think these days from kind of from perspective nonlinear optics and nonlinear waves, his results on vector nonlinear Schrödinger equation and free wave interaction is now really common working tools. And one another thing to remind that in principle he also had some results on a non-integrable system, in particular his work with Vladimir Zakharov on dispersion management systems in a limit of strong dispersion management. It's also now quite well known, although there is no trouble in the sense that Mark Ablevitz's group, where usually sometimes not cited, as usual, they first cite in first couple works, now sometimes we cite it themselves, but still this work is, you know, it was really first work on this limit, and it's well known. Okay, in my work, there'll be no integrability, some really change compared to previous talks. And let me start from some general remarks about collapses. So collapse, reminding some very basic fact, if you have powerful laser beam entering nonlinear media, then because of nonlinearity, it produces singularity in a finite distance. So this is nonlinear Schrödinger, which describes this behavior. In three dimensions, we have qualitatively similar behavior. If you have short laser beams, it's stretching not only in transverse directions, x and y, during propagation, but also shrinks in time. So we have three-dimensional linear Schrödinger equation. You see, in optics, it's standard z, direction of propagation, and time. We have reverse way role. But from now on, I will just use t as an evolutional variable, keeping in mind, of course, all applications. So in this system, it's really standard now to prove formation of singularity in a finite time using so-called Virial theorem. And now I would like to make first before going to my talk will be extremely practical for some practical application, but first I would like to make some comments about collapses, focusing now on two-dimensional linear Schrödinger equation. So this is basically propagation of long pulses in nonlinear media, like usual glass. Perfectly applicable if duration of pulses is in tenths of picosecond or longer, then it's 2D nonlinear Schrödinger is perfect model. So for this two-dimensional nonlinear Schrödinger equation, we can make the following change of variables. Going to new rescale coordinate, rho from R, rescaled by this time-dependent factor L, and new time, which is this integral, so L at leading order near collapse behaves like square root of tc minus t, tc collapse time, so this is like logarithm. So at infinity, so here with this transformation, finite collapse time is mapped to infinite time in new variable tau. So here we can introduce Lenz transformation, absolutely exact transformation from old variable c to new variable v in this new coordinate and time. We have this extra stretching factor and we have complex phase. So if you plug in this stuff into the nonlinear Schrödinger equation, we obtain this equation. So a new this blow up variables. So here beta is just this quantity. It's adiabatically slowly variant quantity. Now if we just do it expansion, basically all idea of this transformation that we try to sit on collapsing solution and then look on small perturbation around this solution. So we're looking for solution in form of the following series, where we not satisfy basically stationary part of this equation. So it's shown on the next slide. This is solution, you see there is no time derivative neglected. So we solve it for any time, basically for any value of beta. After that, if you plug it into equation from previous slide, then this term will reemerge, but because there is no explicit dependence on tau here, all this derivative will come through parametric differentiation v naught over beta, well, multiplying, of course, on d beta d tau. So this is a typical form of solution. So very special procedure how we choose initial condition here in rho at zero. Basically, we choose it to minimize envelope of these tails, because basically when solution collapses, it tries, you know, to keep maximum and to minimize all tails, so to keep as less as possible on the tails. Then, with such definition, it's becoming absolutely well-defined quantity with V0 as a function of rho. And now we can plug in this approximation into our linear Schrodinger equation in these blow-up variables. So, key, okay, too many clicks. So, key step here, that if I appropriately choose parameters L and B and beta for V0, then in our equation it's perfectly nice approximation to linearize around this correction V1. So V1 is correction to V0. Let me show this again. Yeah, so this is V0, this original solid tone, and this is correction. So, in that sense, for example, even from direct numerics, you can plug in and you see that all the linearities in V1 become absolutely irrelevant, they're extremely small. So, in that sense, we can tell that, of course, this is not integrable. But, in a sense, it has some remnants from integrable systems in the sense of linearizability. So, if we appropriately choose parameters for V0, then nonlinear terms completely irrelevant, and then we can work with linear with this linear PDE. And this is basically a reason why for collapses, for this strong nonlinear phenomena, we can get some analytic collapses. So, what is important? So, this system will be remain valid in the sense that nonlinearity in V1 is not important. We need to make sure it's safe on all times, particularly we need this for rho of the order of 1. And we also need second condition that on large tails we have only outgoing waves. So basically, because we shrink and we collapse in solution, nothing could come back. It would be really super special initial condition to provide any such effects. Only outgoing conditions. So basically what we're doing here, we project on space in V1, which is orthogonal to all trivial deformations, like trivial linear modes of linear system, like rescaling, for example, of our L. If you're doing that, then we can arrive to this strongly nonlinear system of ODEs. So basically what we're doing again, we have linear PDE and all nonlinearity just comprise in a highly nonlinear but ODEs. So in that sense again, it's something which remotely reminds integrable systems, but only in very special form and very special time. Now this system of nonlinear system of ODEs we can still solve asymptotically near collapse, and this is just answer for our L. So our dependence of our scale, this is explicit formula, well, it's asymptotic expansion, where A is this proximate logarithm of Tc minus T times some factor which depends on initial conditions. What is question?
В начальных уравнениях бета это коэффициент при второй производной по времени с дисперсией.
Sorry. Yeah, because it was in three-dimensional case, I mentioned here, I focus on two-dimensional case. So, yeah, you're right. It's, yeah.
You're completely right. That it was
not misprint, but duplicate notation. Okay. Now comparison with numerics. So, of this formula. So, this is result L of T as a function of Tc minus T. So, near collapse, L goes to zero. Remember, amplitude is 1 over L. So here, solid lines, it's a numerics for different initial conditions, and this dashed line, just these values from this formula. And this result, it's a previous classical result on log-log scaling, which is really far away for any reasonable numerics from simulations. And in fact, what we can do after we have much more accurate formula, basically, you look here, remember, logarithm A is a logarithm approximate to Tc minus T. So this log of A is a double logarithm of Tc minus T. So if we double logarithm is recovered, but it will be recovered for extremely high amplitudes. Now something more towards practical applications. So this is the result when we start from Gaussian initial condition. So solid line direct simulation, this is an analytical formula. After approximately decrease L three times, we have very good convergence. So we start from something non-linear equation, very far from any integrable case, and that's approximate sense of linearized equation. But when we wait until amplitude increases three times, after that we have analytical failure. So means that in that sense, collapse, this analysis of collapse will become a really practical tool. For comparison, I mentioned that previously in some talks at Landau, but if you compare with old standard result for double logarithm, this old result, they will converge to this my new result only when amplitude of solution goes to this double exponent, 10 to the power 10 to the power 100, which turns out a special name, Googleplex, which of course are absolutely unphysical. Again, this new theory working when amplitude increases about three times. Now, another example case when we have nonlinear Schrödinger equation, when we introduce regularization. So we can look for multiple collapses. This is correspond to so-called two-photon absorption. So here we have formation of collapses, then disintegration into cylindrical waves, and then these waves see new collapses. So there is such turbulent picture. And here there is another rule that because fluctuation of background is reasonably large, it's not so optimal initial seed as previous Gaussian from previous slide. But still, when amplitude of collapse above 4 or 5 times above background, we see that each single collapse and each of these peak is really quite nearly perfect approximation of our rescaled solitaire. Okay.
Is this simulation with initial conditions?
Yeah, this simulation with initial condition, and similar, we had simulation with forcing. Basically, with initial condition, we cannot wait for too long, because otherwise, you know, eventually it will be decaying turbulence. But there is reasonable range when everything working fine, and we have the same PDF. Okay, now, after all these initial things, let's go to some really super practical part of this talk, but I need to do some introduction, why all this is important. So this is all this talk will be how to produce powerful laser beams, not only powerful, but beams which laser beam which carries large average power, not just short beam which produce, you know, burst of high power for short time, but average power would be very small. So previously, for many years, this is of course a field where it was huge investment. Different types of lasers were in front. And around 1988, it was invention of what is called fiber lasers. So in first experiment was made around 1989-1990, and you see it started with powers like 2-3 watts. It was, you know, nobody paid attention to that. But this power of this continuous wave laser means operate all time, it grows very, very quickly. You see, it's a logarithmic scale, so basically it increases exponentially. And around last year, it reached more than 10 kilowatts by a single company, PG Photonics, but some other groups were reach a little bit smaller values. And in principle, now there is announcement even 50 kilowatt laser. There is also another way to do ultra-short lasers, but with high repetition rate, so with red dots, it's alternative type of lasers, but still here we worry on the average power to really, you know, damage some stuff, not just produce, you know, some detection. It's really, we're talking about really powerful lasers. Okay, now, now let me give you an idea why all these advances were possible, this fiber laser. So what's the structure of fiber laser? We have fiber core, something like one or several microns diameter. So it reminds usual fiber, but also we have additional what is called cladding. So then we have pump from usual diodes, wave pump. Light, and this light travels many times because of total internal reflection of boundaries. It travels many times and many times going through this core. So in core we have some active atoms, so this pump excites atoms, and then there is a reaction, so it produces this coherent laser beam. So this is key idea. And as I mentioned from previous slide, experimental progress was really dramatic of, let me see, like 4 orders of magnitude, now more than 4 orders of magnitude, for the last 25 years. Really overpacing growth of any other type of laser systems. So what's the huge advantage of these fiber lasers? They don't need really any alignment. Basically, you have some fiber, you don't need some mirrors, adjust, you don't need some guy, especially if you have some critical application, like shooting something, yeah, you don't want some guy sitting adjusting screwdriver. Then, another advantage, they are very efficient, very efficiency 50% and more, very, very compact, but around 3-4 years ago, basically, development of these lasers practically hit walls. Because we encountered what is called mode instabilities. Basically, there are still debates exact origin of instabilities, there are competing theories, but more or less you have, you inevitably, over fiber is very transparent, but for such high intensity, still there are some thermal distortion. And it looks like special modes occurs, and basically nobody can overcome that limit. This company IPG Photonics, it looks like they several times overcome, although nobody knows how. It's, you know, talking with experimenters in this field, basically everybody entered into this company, established by Valery Gaponsov. It's actually now a big company. I just for curiosity recently look on their stocks because now it's yes. And, I mean, they based, I think their main operation in Massachusetts cost like $4-5 billion, but we also have some facilities in Russia also. Anyway, let's go to this. So, yeah, by the way, this is example of their lasers. So, each laser which produced now 50 kilowatts, it's something like size of small fridge. Basically, you just need electric, you know, source of electricity, and then here you connect fibers and you get. So now mostly we're using for application, right, cutting something, or now we're even using it, started using for oil well drilling. We have enough power. So just for comparison, recently in Albuquerque we have review guy who was for many years in charge of all laser research in Air Force. He mentioned that somewhere like in end of 70s, to produce some comparable power, average power, so laser, average power, we use chemical laser, basically it was factory, like huge factory with some walls like 20 meters high, and it was extremely inefficient, so progress is really big. But again, for these fiber lasers, we have really hitting wall. So way to overcome this, in some sense it's natural. Idea is to combine many laser beams. So this idea is around for a while. There are different schemes. For example, here we put many lasers and try to focus it on something. But the trouble that if these different schemes, if you just combine several beams, total beam will be not coherent. So it will not allow any long range propagation. You know, if you cut something in a few millimeters, it's okay, but if you want long-range propagation, it will not work. So to overcome this difficulty, yeah, by the way, just from popular literature, this is typically idea what to do when we combine several laser beams to produce one powerful laser beam. So one of the, I would say, practically the only real idea which is around now, subject of current research, is what is called coherent beam combined. So idea that we combine several laser beams, let me schematic put like that, and carefully choosing phase, so together they form some coherent laser beam. So we need very tight control of phase from each laser beam. But there are serious obstacles on that, because you already have strong power, basically non-linearity kills everything. We have environmental fluctuations, so phases in different lasers fluctuates, and you really need expensive adaptive optics to try to fix that, you know, dynamically in time. And success still quite limited, all the big resources now spent on that. So typical example, one of the best example that people combine 500 watt lasers into 1.9 kilowatts. So it's, you know, here they achieve good beam quality. If you just don't need beam quality, you don't need long range propagation, of course you can just combine many, but it will be not efficient for any propagation. So, key idea of talk, of my talk, of my proposal here, is that instead of looking on linearity as our enemy, try to use linearity to our advantage. And key idea that we just combine many laser beams, we not try to adjust their faces by any way, instead we just provoke collapse. And collapse immediately will produce a coherent beam. So in that sense, settings reasonably close to this simulation with many collapses which I showed before, except here in fact we need single collapse. So what's the scheme which we're proposing here? So we're looking for multimode optical fiber, so it means that we have many modes propagating in fiber. When we combine, for example, several hundreds laser beams at entrance, so basically their relative phase uncorrelated. Each small beam is coherent, but phases are fluctuating, they're not correlated. Mm-hmm. So after short propagation, we will have randomization, we will have complete random field. So this is three-dimensional plot, vertical axis just amplitude. So initially you see we are stuck with beams in the form of hexagon, approximately imitate fiber, and then look for propagation. And then after reasonably enough propagation, we see formation of collapse. And when we measure beam quality, we see it's absolutely perfect. Again, what we know from previous examples, I showed you that increase of amplitude 4-5 times produced nearly perfect beam. Yeah, and by the way, from point of view of simulations of nonlinear Schrödinger equation.
Perfect, but not Gaussian, yeah?
Well, it's very close to Gaussian. Yeah, it's not exactly Gaussian, but from point of view of beam quality, it's comparable. You know, we really want to have really nice phase, because phase is what is killing everything. Okay. Now, yeah, by the way, from point of view simulations, this is just a linear Schrödinger equation with linear potential. Linear potential simply keeps on this transverse direction, it imitate our fiber. It's actually a very good model here, as soon as angle of propagation not very large. So this, when we have reflection, angle shouldn't be too large, so the linear Schrödinger will work. So simulations here straightforward. It's still supercomputer simulations because we need to resolve many scales, but otherwise theoretical model is quite clear and understandable. So now what's happening? Here I plot maximum of amplitude in this field of C of our field. You see it's fluctuate until it collapses. If additionally we introduce regularization, there are media which provide some regularization. Basically, what will happen after that, this is blue curve, it stabilizes, and you see here amplitude around 10, initial amplitude about 1. So intensity increase 100 times, and beam here is nearly perfect. Still, there is, of course, remaining background. Not everything, of course, here absorbed is to collapse. And basically, our proposal in such a case to make a ring cavity from fiber, so light will travel like this, and here we have, for example, we can put in the center of fiber material with high nonlinearity, so collapse will have tendency collapse in the center, and then we just will remove it after each round three.
What about losses?
Well, losses here with fiber allows many kilometers of typical length of propagation. I will get, will give physical estimates in a bit. Okay, so let me, before going to physical estimates, some things about PDF. So this is PDF for collapse distance. So basically what we have to do, we need to provide some way regularization of collapse, not avoiding breaking glass, or whatever media we have. Because another suggestion, for example, to have capillary field with gas. Then in such a case, nonlinearity will be not so strong, but we will still have collapse, and of course collapse in the gas, well, after we switch off laser, it's immediately recover. Plasma recover, everything will be good. Now here just some examples. For example, 100 combined beams, 64, and there is some average distance. So what is important here, what we can introduce our understanding of statistics for such systems. We can look for larger distance of propagation. Basically, we decrease total power. If total power is smaller, then we need more times until we produce catastrophic collapse. But what is interesting here that as long as we propagate, we see we decrease power distance, average distance, so middle of this PDF increasing, but width basically remains almost around 15%. So there is a scaling law of power 2.5 for this increase of distance. So basically there is always compromise. More power we put, faster we have collapse, or maybe put less power, but to have collapse faster, occur faster.
Ваша проблема with width frequency of output.
Well, frequency, it's a... Okay, let me, frequency I will tell in a minute. Let me first know, I mean, it's reasonable what you're asking, it's a pretty reasonable question, but it's easy to answer for me, because I studied this. So, what's interesting we see? We see here, now, no time here. Remember, kind of to avoid confusion, this is a linear Schrodinger equation where z plays a role of time. So I'm not talking about physical time, only distance of propagation. So here, dependence of correlation length. So basically, we look each cross section of fiber, we're looking for correlation length. So, and this is correlation length averaged over realizations. So for different colors, basically different total power. So correlation length has a tendency of increasing until some threshold value where it triggers collapse. So basically you see here, obviously inverse cascade, and my interpretation over quantitative theory still has to be done, but more or less I think I understand what's going on. So our fluctuation, which we check, almost Gaussian, until collapse. So when we're looking for optimal fluctuation of Gaussian random field to trigger collapse, it's much easier, you know, it's well-known theory that form of this large fluctuation will have form of correlation, spatial correlation function. So this basically will be correlation length for this large fluctuation. And it's much easier to increase amplitude above average than to increase width for this random Gaussian field. So basically system waits until inverse cascade reach one of these points, large enough correlation length, and then, you know, basically during propagation we basically scan ensemble of such fluctuation until we trigger collapse. Okay. So at least qualitatively I think
there is collapse in unavoidable because it's inverse cascade.
Yeah, in principle, if you need that losses, I would say, you know, let me be more accurate. In principle, if you neglect losses completely, when we perhaps wait in almost infinitely long, eventually collapse will occur. But here it's really speed up collapse. Because if not inverse cascade, we might have to wait for exponentially larger time, which may be, you know. In any physical system, of course, losses would be important. Okay, now physical estimate. So this is not really a Schrodinger equation in physical units. We have k, it's a wave number, and 2 is this hair coefficient. So this is basically our index of refraction, has linear part and not, and part proportional to laser intensity. So it's easy to estimate typical parameters. I take this wavelength, which is now currently most convenient for fiber lasers. It's not the same wavelength as optical communications, but still here losses are still quite small. So still typical propagation length in fiber several kilometers for linear losses. So when we immediately estimate critical power, it's 4.7 megawatts. Here NC is this number of particles from ground state soliton basically comes from this theory which I described at the beginning of this talk. Now, we can ask question, well, what it means, how big fiber we need. There is experimental rule, basically, now after reading Newberg's experiments, that for continuous wave operation of laser, it's safe to have about between 10 and 20 watts per square micron. If you write in units watt per square centimeter, it's 10 to 1. Basically rule that in that case, either water cooling or air cooling is enough. So when we estimate in our parameters typical distance needed to achieve collapse, it's a typical example, it's 4 meters, and we need optical fiber diameter between 1 and 2 millimeters. Actually, 1 millimeter optical fiber is already commercially available from the same IPG photonics, because we use it, you know, to deliver. I think now we currently use for the powerful laser for drilling around 2 meters lasers. So at least for 200 meters. Linear losses, of course, exist, but compared to total power, it's some really small fraction. Now, if we go to short pulse operations, so in that sense, for example, experimentally, it would be much easier to demonstrate such things, because lasers, of course, with such huge power, first of all, very expensive, and you really need serious facility, because, you know, just any misalignment, you start destroying walls around, it's not good to do that. So for demonstration, what we propose, we better do for short pulses. So power, when for short pulses, scaling power absolutely not a problem, and actually threshold is much larger. For example, for 8 nanosecond pulses, this power, you see, it's more than almost 3 orders of magnitude higher. For 14 picosecond pulses, it's even, how many, it's like 3 times more. So it's more than 3 orders. So we really can make system really small. It's absolutely not a problem. Now, answering Igor's question about frequencies. So what we need here, in fact, we need some temporal bandwidth, because there is another effect which is called stimulated brilliant scattering, which produces instability. So to suppress that, we either need pulses which at least a few nanoseconds or shorter, I think it's shorter than 10 nanoseconds, typical experimental observation. Or we just need modulate phase a little bit. So in that sense, we need to reduce temporal quality of laser a little bit to avoid this instability completely. Now, if you go for two short pulses, then beta, this first beta, which if you must, which you mentioned, with really three-dimensional linear Schrodinger will come into play. But typical for distance of propagation, which we need here, you know, with 14 picoseconds still safe. If you go to something like a couple picoseconds, then this effect start to become important. So we really have huge range of applicability of all this stuff.
That collapse itself doesn't produce large lift in frequency. I understand that this characteristic is not important, but it is.
Well, of course, let me jump into the beginning of this talk and explain the equation. It will be much easier. Okay. So basically, if you take into account time, we have this three-dimensional linear Schrodinger equation. So beta here, group velocity dispersion. Again, it's not beta from collapse. So if we have long pulses, something like, you know, longer than a few picoseconds, then for typical distance of propagation, these terms completely neglected. So we just collapse in x and y in other directions. So there is no significant increase of bandwidth. Of course, if we go for short pulses, sub-picosecond, when basically we start producing this optical bullet, what is called optical bullet shaking in time, when basically we produce delta functions, we produce all very wide temporal spectrum. In fact, in reality, before we really reach very large bandwidth, you know, this nonlinear Schrodinger equation will be not applicable. We need to take into account higher order terms. Eventually, we have to solve some sort of Maxwell equation. So I think, yeah, that's not a trouble. So to conclude, I think our proposal potentially quite practical. It's maybe not super cheap to realize, but basically this estimate suggests, just to be on a little bit popular side, but if you're looking for some science fiction, this device, imagine, it's 1 millimeter thick, several meters, just, you know, weight of such a piece of fiber, it will be a couple grams. Well, basically you can put in really small device. Of course, question, so you can have this laser gun, which I just for curiosity, I estimate what is the power. Power of this 4.7 megawatts is approximately equivalent to kinetic power if Abrams tank make one shot of each 2 seconds, or it's equivalent about 10 shots, I mean, from gun, 10 shots of T-34 per second. So it's power in principle, which is even several, about order higher than minimum requirement of military. But of course here main question, well, we still need power source. I think all yes, others, so if in the future some...
source of power, you don't have us here, laser itself.
Yeah. But laser, not only laser, we can do it reasonably easy, but also here, my key point, we can combine in a powerful laser beam, because you need critical power, you cannot do it much smaller. Yeah. I mean, I think with diode switch pump, we become more and more efficient, and progress is very quick, but of course, you know, source of power in several megawatts, it's maybe not what we immediately expect to have, you know, in compact design. But in principle, even if you look on modern tank where engine it gives about 1 megawatt. So it's for such size of devices. So I think now mostly what we plan to do in air carriers where we have a lot of electricity, but of course I think we're not planning for now fiber lasers, it's remain for a future. We're doing some different types of solid state lasers. Okay, thank you.
Very interesting speaker. So, questions? Yeah?
Can it be applied to the gravitational collapse of the, say, Bose star? It's also described by the non-linear Schrödinger equation as gravitation.
I think this is too simple model for gravitational collapse. I think Gage, not here, made some estimates that we really need to applicability, we really need some huge objects, because when we shrink, non-linear Schrödinger will not work. Well, personally, I did not make such estimates. So I think for gravitational collapses, perhaps, you know, not detailed enough model. My interpretation.
Okay. So, what is the physical source of regularization, the collapse in your system?
Yeah, in my system, basically, in this publication, which appeared just a couple of weeks ago in Optics Letters, we suggest six different ways of regularization. It really depends on media. Six ways, you know. I mean, it's still a problem. One way is to use so-called Chalcogenic glasses, we have huge nonlinearity, but also we produce saturation. Another, what I mentioned already, for example, to have any gas or liquid instead of solid glass. When it just produce pulse, plasma, but you switch plasma off and it just recovers. Another most sophisticated ways, it's basically to have carefully chosen transverse profile of this laser. So if this is cross-section, we basically create gradient of nonlinearity, so when pulses drift into this direction, and then periodically we remove, just by extra small fiber, we remove this excess. Mm-hmm. Well, there are different ways, but, you know, this is definitely technological challenge.
Yeah, we have
some ideas, but...
Okay.
How can the electrical field of the light
wave
at such a power focus
compared
with atomic field?
Well, still, before collapse, where we want to operate, it's still small. Because it's very transparent media, I think it's maybe a couple orders from atomic field, maybe even more. Two, three orders. But if we just not careful enough, we allow catastrophic collapse, it immediately produces plasma. Basically destroy media when, of course, it's all comparable.
What do you mean by optical damage? Heating or kind of discharge?
No, it's produced plasma. It's very quick. You know, any any damage very quick goes to plasma. So it's so huge intensities that it's actually now optical technology, what is called
ionization. Ionization.
Yeah, of course.
Not heating.
Yeah, not heating. Heating we can manage reasonably just by water cooling. Here it's really ionization. Yeah, very quick ionization. It happens. Basically, it's a multi-photon ionization. Mm-hmm. Not even regular multi-photon here more efficient.
Mm-hmm. And irreversible.
Yeah, for glass, of course. If you use liquid or gas, it's reversible. But if we use, it's actually now currently optical technology called optical inscription. We really use it to create some profile of all properties inside optical fiber by this effect. Of course, we may use it for ultrashort pulses, so damage not too large. So we just do small change. Basically, we do some damage, plasma recovers, and property modulated anyway. So basically, it's a way how to create some wavelength structure inside fiber.
Okay.
And last, political question. Is this power enough to be a weapon?
Yeah, of course.
Yes, of course.
military requirement, minimum requirements, it's 100 kilowatts. Mm-hmm. What we have, now you see, it's 50 times more.
So, but I have a question concerning, is it possible somehow instead of one fiber used, but just a fiber array, and it could mean probably maybe it's the effect might be the same or less, but the collapse in such a case, I think, can be controlled by size or the distance between fibers, etc.
You see, this picture basically assumes that, because here I do not want to go into details, we assume that it could be some holy fiber, basically small holes.
Ah, so you have.
So basically, it's kind of what, in a way, what you suggest, but a little bit more advanced, because when we have this integrated structure, losses will be less than if you just put fibers together. But, I mean, you're thinking about exactly the right direction,
Okay. Let us thank the speaker again. So, the last talk today.